Thank you. hear about Shakespeare. I'm Dr. David Sweeten. I'm an early British professor here at Early British Literature Professor here at Eastern. Let me just say what a treat this has been so far, and kind of a great example of some of the things I'm actually going to talk about here. So, when attending an event such as this one, I often have to pause and ask myself, why Shakespeare? What is it about his plays and poetry that carries on the imaginary? What precisely has led to these texts remaining so popular for the past 400 years? At the start of this term, I asked some of my students, what makes a piece of literature a canonical or a classic text? And their answer was, and I quote, "It's written by a dead white guy." So I pressed the conversation and asked who gets to decide what texts are considered by those canonical examples of literature. And they reprised their answer, a group of other dead white guys. So both of these answers are, to a large extent, accurate, and say a lot about how we perceive established pieces of literature. But for another dead white guy, William Shakespeare's work is very much alive. A quick search on the Internet Movie Database reveals that there were 41 film adaptations or reimaginings of Shakespeare's plays in 2016 alone. 41, just last year, right? To be clear, that doesn't include TV episodes, of which there were many. Short films are stage productions. There's also several stage companies who put on multiple productions of Shakespeare's plays annually, most notably the Royal Shakespeare Company and the London Players, not to mention local, annual Shakespearean festivals throughout the U.S. and regular productions in community, university, and high school theaters. The fact that we are all here and momentarily about to see a musical interpretation of Shakespeare's soliloquies and sonnets reinforces just how alive Shakespeare's work remains today. Before we get into that performance, I want to talk briefly about why Shakespeare may have remained so relevant, why his poetry and drama maintains this relevance, and why interpretations of his work, like the musical performance before us, are so important. So, why Shakespeare? Another dead white guy, but what is it about him that generates this kind of staying power? Surprisingly, we don't actually know as much about William Shakespeare as we'd like. The figure we call William Shakespeare was born in Stratford-upon-Avon, a moderately small town in northwest London, in 1564. His father was a glovemaker and a prominent figure in the town's local government. We know that he married Anne Hathaway, not that one, in 1582. Now, that marriage was rushed and may have been a shotgun wedding, pressured by Hathaway's family, especially considering that their first child was born just under 6 months later. At some point after this, Shakespeare moved to London and was credited as a playwright for the first time in 1592. In any case, Shakespeare's role as a playwright in London gave him contact with the culturally prominent figures of London and even Queen Elizabeth I and later King James I's courts. All of this is interesting to varying degrees, but none of it really explains why Shakespeare's work has maintained such prominence. Renaissance London certainly didn't lack for poets, playwrights. In Shakespeare's day, Kit Marlowe's plays, were better known, and Ben Jonson's poetry was actually better circulated than Shakespeare's himself. Yet, as years passed, Shakespeare's work stood out from the rest and continued to do so. There is, however, a quality of Shakespeare's work that enables adaptations like the performance we're going to see tonight, and that's dramatic tension. I'm going to talk a little bit about that. So, with Shakespeare's play, dramatic tension seems a prerequisite, right? But I'd like to look at the sonnets to demonstrate how this tension works. Shakespearean sonnets, unlike the form borrowed from Petrarch or later adaptations, follow a clear formula that allow for unfolding of the poem's subject matter. You might all recognize the form of the sonnet from an English class, the standard 14 lines, alternating rhyme schemes, and a concluding couplet, the old A, B, A, B, C, B, C, D, E, F, E, F, G, G, which we had to memorize. More than that, however, Shakespeare breaks down his sonnets according to three quatrains, or sections of four lines, and a final couplet. Each of these sections has a distinct purpose. The first provides an exposition of the main theme or subject matter. The second extends that theme of the imagery, often complicating or developing it. The third introduces a conflict or a twist, something that interrupts the theme or presents an issue surrounding it. The final, and its final couplet, and its rhyming lines, concludes and often presents the solution or mediation for the problem. talking about this in the abstract seems so instructive. So let's briefly look at one of the sonnets that's actually in the program that we're going to hear in a musical form. If you look at sonnet 116. So here, as in many of Shakespeare's sonnets, the theme is love. But an interesting dynamic is how that love is defined. In addition to expanding on this component of love, the process of this poetic structure itself emphasizes dramatic tension as the audience moves through the poem. The statement of theme challenges perceptions of love, which we often associate with fickleness and impulsive behavior, causing the reader to ask what then love is by the end of that first quatrain. When we get to our second, our perception of love is redefined to constancy, emphasize first the position of love as that ever-fixed mark, and then extolling the storms of weathers before emphasizing the worth of attaining that love. As we move into the third quatrain, time is presented as a challenge to love, as age will wither beauty, and the affections that come with the flesh will also lead to that decline of love. But proper love, we read, is untouched by time, waiting till the end. Each of these points not only presents its theme and associated imagery, but imagines the process of reading the poem, the reader responding and reacting to its lines, and capitalizes on those reactions to drive the reader further to the poem's conclusion. The dramatic potential of this poem, then, lies in the weight of the function of each line carrying forward, pushing the reader in one direction, or better, pull them in another as the poem progresses. This dramatic tension is prevalent in all of Shakespeare's work, poetry and drama alike. And let me just say, we've actually already seen several good examples of expanding dramatic tension from poetry in music form, right? Few authors in the English language demonstrate the same understanding of this dramatic potential for a phrase, a line, or even just a word in the larger context of the sonnet, the monologue, or the play at large. What makes Shakespeare truly stand out then is this understanding of that dramatic potential and how the work affects his audience. We've long seen this in his dramatic work, as actors and directors make interpretive choices from Shakespeare's text to drive their own narratives. What's intriguing about tonight's performance is seeing more levels of interpretation in Shakespeare's drama and poetry through the music from the composer, the vocalist, and the musician, all taking up that dramatic potential in these texts and weaving new threads within them. All too often, we read texts like Shakespeare's, we reify them as solely words on the page to be read. Performances like tonight's help us understand that art is neither created nor received in a vacuum, and the new layers that these performers add can enrich our understanding of Shakespeare, his texts, and art at large. Thanks.